That is real good. That is good. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. We welcome every one of us to another edition of Daybreak with the King on Facebook Live, and these two platforms host the 2018 Masterclass, and we are on a course on grace. And today we had a ministry from Apostle Hilda and Minister Marilyn Todd, who on both sides of the Atlantic, Apostle Hilda in Braintree, Essex, and Mr. Marilyn Todd in Michigan, United States, they uphold the day in prayer on Daybreak with the King. And if you have grace to pray, we want to have more intercessors. We want to cover every single day, every single hour of the day, as the Father told us in what is called 24/7 Global Prayer Center. If you can pray for 1 hour on behalf of the remnant, not about bread and butter, please connect with us. Let us know on Facebook Live. Let us know in the classroom on Facebook, so that we can deploy to make sure that the 24 hours are covered. It's one of the visions that has not yet been fulfilled, and we know that great things await those that pray. And so we thank the Father. Today we're going to be having ministry from two of our principal officers and mentors, Apostle Dennis Williams and Prophet Rolanda Bird. When we finish the teaching, they will come on and exhort the 2018 Masterclass students. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege to come before you without anything other than our need for your grace for today. The grace for today is not the same as grace for yesterday. Therefore, as we come to you to meet you in your word, let it please you to release to us great grace to be and to do that which you have ordained to accomplish through our beings. And let your name be glorified. Holy Spirit, have your way, that Yeshua be made manifest in our life. In Yeshua's mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Today in lesson 6 of the awesome course 107, Grace, the Basis of Kingdom Life and Ministry, we'll be speaking with you about grace and the Great Commission. Grace as a primary instrument of the Great Commission. I want you to listen carefully, because today, even when I was before the Lord this morning, he began to even expand what we knew, what he gave us before. So there's an expansion. Don't say you have had it before. There's some other things the Father has touched on to really bring the punch in this message. As Ephesians 2:1-8 clearly states, grace is the only way that sinners can come into a relationship with the Father. The only way for salvation. No works, no effort, is only by grace, through faith. So that is why Elohim does not take home saints when we are born again. When we are born again, he doesn't take us home. Why? There is work to be done on this side of eternity. And the Father had a prayer that Yeshua prayed in John 17. Yeshua said, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, in verse 9. But for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. Then there's something important he said in verse 15. I pray not that thou shouldest. Father, I don't want you to take away those you have given to me. Don't take them out of this world, but keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, the same way you, Father, sent me, now I hand over the baton to them. The relay race of the Great Commission is now in their hand. I've done my own part. Now I hand over to them. That's what he was saying there. Men and brethren, and he said, it's not just the 12 disciples, or it's not just those who were with him. He said in verse 20, need I pray for these alone, but for them also, which shall believe of me through their word. Brethren, it is therefore sad to see, and what we'll be going to study this morning is some of the deeper dimensions and applications of grace, because a lot of people misuse or squander grace on two dimensions. Number one, there are those who use grace as a crutch to hang on their sinful lifestyle and preferences. They commit a sin before anything, no conviction, no repentance. Well, grace covers it. Well, grace covers me. Grace. And they have that attitude. Presumptuous sin, even where Holy Spirit warns them, don't go for that. Don't take that appointment. Don't take that call. Don't go on that trip. That party you are going, there may be defilement. Don't go. The girl say, well, grace covers me. So you open your eyes and walk into sin and expect grace to cover you. You better be careful, because to despise grace is to be in a dangerous place. The second set of people are those who use grace in a utilitarian fashion. So grace becomes the slot machine. They just slot in to cash out their casino hall. And so it's just grace. Grace is for bread, it's for butter, it's for stomach, it's for need, it's for ambition. Now that is pondering of grace. Grace is for something more profound. There's a reason why we kept alive. And the Father today wants to remind us so that we don't have any mistake, any misunderstanding of this reality, that we are kept alive to seek the kingdom and his righteousness. And there's no greater way to seek the kingdom and his righteousness than to be immersed in the critical duty of partnering with Elohim to ensure that as many appointed to salvation receive the grace to be saved and become citizens of the kingdom, and thereby the population of the kingdom is enlarged. So in effect, the greatest thing any true recipient of grace, anyone who is saved, the greatest thing we can ever do is to come to a place where grace opens our eyes, grace propels us, grace empowers us to get about the kingdom business described in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 from verse 17. He says, therefore, if any man be in Yeshua, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Most times we stop there. When we stop there, we are cherry-picking scripture. We don't stop there because it is not the idea to stop there. He now went on to verse 18, and all things are of Elohim, who has reconciled us to himself by Yeshua, and had given to us, he has, one, reconciled us to Yeshua, reconciled us to himself through Yeshua, and then number two, he gives to us the ministry of reconciliation. He reconciles us so that he can send us to the ministry of reconciliation. Then he said, to wit, that Elohim was in Yeshua, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Yeshua. As though Elohim did beseech you by us, we pray you in Yeshua's stead, be ye reconciled to Elohim, for he had made him, that's Yeshua, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of Elohim in him. In other words, men and brethren, to get on with the kingdom business of reconciling the lost is the greatest way we can channel grace, because there's no greater assignment than the human soul, the eternal soul of man, spirit and soul of man, to find its way back to a connection with the Father so that eternal life can be lived with him. And therefore, if we know it, grace will enable us to use the opportunity we have. Yeshua said in John chapter 4 from verse 35, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages, and gathereth unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And therein is the saying true, one soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap that whereon you bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye have entered into your labors. Now, it tells us something, that when we are talking about grace and not works, it means this, that concerning the Great Commission, each of us has a measure of grace to do some things, but that which we do is not all. For instance, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 3, I have planted, Apollos watered, and Elohim gave the increase. Now listen, what does he mean? There are times when, if we understand the Great Commission, that the Father may use you to pray in somebody, cover somebody in prayer. That prayer may propel that person to go in a particular direction where he meets somebody, and the person he meets, the word he brings does not bring that person to salvation, but it starts something. It sparks something. It sparks a thought. And then ultimately, something happens, and that person surrenders, and it could be to another person. Somebody may be saved by the preaching of a ministry, but that ministry may not have what it takes to nurture that person basically. And the Father channels that person to somewhere they can receive basic nurture, milk. And then later, he gets them to where they can eat strong meat. So what are we saying? The Great Commission is something that requires collective action. When you are functioning in grace, there's no competition, there's no strife, there's no grandstanding, there's no trying to, show everybody that it's me alone that can do it. No, the paradigm is that of corporality. So there are seven main things in the Great Commission that, to make the Great Commission complete, there are seven things, seven dimensions the Father wants us to share today. And as we share them, you now check, where do you have grace for? That place you have grace, invest your all in it. Where do you have some little grace for? Do the little you can and trust the Father that he will complete it. Now, what are the seven dimensions? Number one, preaching the gospel of salvation by grace through faith. This is something every believer should be able to do. It doesn't matter whether you're called to the fivefold, you're called to the deaconate, you are called to be an exhorter. It doesn't matter whether you are no calling, nothing as you think, but everyone is called to something or the other. But you know what? Every single person redeemed by the blood is automatically enlisted into the ambassadorial functions of the kingdom. And our job is to open our mouth and declare the truth that Elohim says. What are some of those truths? Number one, John 3:16. For Elohim so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, whosoever, no matter how hard-hearted, it's not your job to judge. Whosoever believeth, he alone knows. And you know what? Our job is to reach out to everybody within our loop of influence to tell them that Elohim loves them and has made provision for them. That whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For Elohim sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It's very simple. Let us go forth everywhere, in our neighborhood, in our workplaces, anywhere we find ourselves, the mall, sharing the love of Yeshua, even if it means handing out tracts to do the talking where there is not much opportunity to talk, even if it means finding creative ways to talk about it. And look at the beauty of this thing. We are told in Romans chapter 10 that it's not difficult. The process is to raise Yeshua in the esteem of the people so much so that if people can only believe in their hearts and confess with their tongue, they are saved. Then we are told in Ephesians 2 that it's by grace through faith that we are saved. So what it means is this: let's stop breaking our head about how many people we brought to the Lord or not didn't bring to the Lord. He said, just go. Just open your mouth wide. The Father will feel it. Tell people about Elohim, the Father who loves them. Tell people about the Savior who had paid the price on the cross of Calvary about 2,000 years ago for their sins, and that no sin is too difficult, no sin is too bad that the blood cannot blot it out. Tell people that they are loved. Tell people that all they need to do is to set aside the arguments and believe in their heart that he has paid the price already, confess with their tongue, and they are saved. And listen to this. Tell people that according to Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. In other words, it's through him. He is still the way, the truth, and the life. Some of the older ministers may deny that. Some of the younger plastic cross ministers may deny that. But you and I must know that he alone is the way, the truth, and the life. If we believe that, then we're going to try to reach out to all our neighbors, all our friends, all our relatives. And getting on with this thing is a duty, is a primary ministry every single one who is born again is given. Number two, component of the Great Commission is making disciples of those who are saved. How do we make disciples of them? Through intentional and systematic process of teaching them the constitution of the kingdom. The word of Elohim is the constitution of the kingdom. Yeshua said in Matthew 28, teaching them to observe all things that I've taught you. In other words, what is the kingdom culture on life? What's the kingdom culture on marriage? What's the kingdom culture on forgiveness? What's the kingdom culture? If we begin to ask questions that way and begin to answer the questions of life of the people to the degree that what they used to have in their mind about their culture, well, I think this is from Liberia or Uganda. May somebody help me over there. Or it is either from Liberia or Uganda. Went there back to back. You know, I went to Liberia, spent a few days there and flew to Uganda. And so I got this as a gift to one of them. Now, each nation has a culture. That culture is the way people think and the way they speak and the way they live. So people have lived the way they live for years. Now you have brought them to Yeshua. They are saved. Their spirit man is saved. But their mind, it has stored up memory. And there is a way they live. Then now you now begin to take the word to begin to deal with their mindset, to dislodge strongholds of how they used to think, how they used to live, and then plant the culture of the kingdom inside them. That's what discipleship is really all about. It's intentional. It's not done casually. And it is done when we take responsibility. We are told in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace in Yeshua. And the things that thou hast heard of me, Paul told Timothy, among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. In other words, you take responsibility to systematically, intentionally use the word of life to take away the word of culture, the lifestyle of culture, so that the culture of the kingdom is planted in them. And you can do this. You can do this during your lunch break. You can do this in a log cabin. You can do this in a, you know, spring is coming in many places. In London, spring has come. Summer is coming. You can do this in the field. It's not just inside the church building. When they do have new believers class, most of the times, new believers classes make people disciples of a church or a denomination of a pastor. But when it comes to discipleship, we are meaning translating people from believing on Yeshua to following Yeshua. And you who are born again, if you press in to be a disciple, then you are qualified to do this to other people. And so we say, by the word of the Lord, every believer should be a disciple maker, should be a disciple who makes other disciples. That is the paradigm of the kingdom. Number three, true disciples need to be transformed through the process of training, equipping, and activation of their gifts and callings and released to serve the Lord as priests after the order of Melchizedek. Now, this third one, you can do it as an individual through social media. You can train people. You can also do it in the, you know, on life. That same person you are discipled, you can actually begin to train that person to be a minister. But more importantly, you can do it better as part of a whole, either in a local assembly that has an empowerment paradigm, a DNA of empowerment. You take your place, bring people to church, you know, where there is a training, let's say a Global School of Ministry Center. You bring other believers who you know are just floating. They may even be disciples, but they not know they are ministers. You bring them to the training center in your ministry, you invite them to come in. You are not asking them to leave their church and come to yours. You're asking them to come and be trained. In London, we have our service 2 to 4 on Sunday. Then 4, people come from other churches. We all have a little meal together or snack together. 4:30 we begin and train till 6:30 or 7. People come from other churches. They finish training, they go back to their churches. We don't even make any effort to try to make them come and be part of our rise, because there's a role for them where they are. And you know what? In every local assembly, GSOM, there comes a time when we should have our eyes open to invite other people so that we don't make it just something ourselves only. We have to be concerned about our brothers and sisters who are born again, who may even be disciples, but they don't have training. Bring them to your Global School of Ministry Center, your local assembly. If you do that, you are doing well. If you are in the master class and you bring people to the master class, well, don't say it's too late. We have a new program called the Yes Course, whereby people can do it. You give them us their email, you know, we enter their email into the system, they are invited into class, and they can study at their own pace. If they'll be overwhelmed by the quantum of what has been done already, 26 lessons, plus today, 6 today, that'll be 32 from me alone, then Pastor Grace and myself, the video. Some people may be overwhelmed. You know what? We advise that they go through the Yes Course pattern platform so that they can be trained. In other words, training may require a corporate effort. Everybody does their own part. You know, this church or local assembly has the training facility. You invite people from outside the church to the training, and they are trained. Or if you are in the master class, you invite people. Or you can tell a pastor you know, listen, I know somewhere they can give you the curriculum and the course notes free of charge for you to train the people. You can do be involved in that. So training is the third part of the Great Commission. The fourth one is, even though we are called out of the world, we are called to be different. We are called to be separate. We are not called to be isolated. That's number 4. The Kingdom Church is not called to isolation. It is called to separation so that we can engage with the world. Men and brethren, the Father makes his goodness to be upon everyone, both the just and the unjust. He doesn't say, well, let the good, my good children enjoy the sunshine, and let those who have not received me stay in bitter winter. No. So the church should be like, we should be like our Father. In other words, the DNA of goodness should be in us. The desire to be a blessing to people where we are planted, the community where we are planted, and other parts of the mission field where we are called to. It is so important that even missionaries don't go empty-handed. Don't just go, yes, I have anointing to heal the sick and raise the dead. Don't go empty-handed if you're going to mission. Go with something. Go with something, not just take care of yourself in mission. There are people you are going to meet there, and $100 can make a difference. $50 can make a difference. Go with something. Raise some money to touch lives, as many people as possible. It is so important. Matthew chapter 5. We are told in verse 13, we are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savour, where we shall be salted? It is then so good for nothing, but to be cast out to be trodden under foot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it on a bushel, but on a candlestick, and give a light to all that in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. Glorify your Father which is in heaven. What does it mean? The Lord says the body of Yeshua on earth has been kept on earth to be the salt of the earth. Salt has 2 main properties. Number 1, salt is a seasoning agent. You may cook food and it's flat, no taste. You take a tincture of salt, the food may be worth the condiments may be worth $100. You went and bought them in the market to cook some beautiful stew or soup, and no salt, is flat. Then you take 10 p worth of salt, or even 5 p worth of salt, to put in food worth $100. That 5 p worth of salt brings the taste of the seafood, of the meat, of the fish together. You can taste it. She said, the church is the salt of the earth. We add value. We season our environment. There's a redemptive purpose. There's a redemptive gift in every people group. And the church within that community, through its activities in the community, is supposed to bring forth the redemptive gift of that community. Then salt is also a preservative. In the olden days, before refrigerators were invented, if you wanted to preserve your fish and your meat, all you did is to salt it, let it dry in the sun for about 2 weeks, then it can stay for 7 years, 5 years, and it's not gone bad. You know what? Any church in a community, our presence should preserve that community from corruption. We cannot see prostitution around us. We're not concerned. You drive for 3 miles, you enter the car park, you know, you park your car, you enter the sanctuary. After church, you enter the car again, drive off, drive across red light districts. It doesn't concern you. People are doing drugs in the neighborhood. It doesn't concern you. People are homeless. It doesn't concern you. That is not his church. His church must be an agent of preservation. In other words, we must be investors in the community. We must be investors in the atrium. We must be investors in the mission field. And I want to thank the Father that some people are getting it. Matthew 25, when the Son of Man, 31, shall come in his glory, and all his holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a sheep divided the sheep from the goats. As a shepherd divided the sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on the right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared to you from the foundation of this world. For I was an hungered, you gave me meat. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, you visited me. I was in prison, you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee, and hungered, and fed thee? Or thirsty, and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger, and took thee in, or naked, and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick, or in prison, and came unto thee? The king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Brethren, this is serious. In other words, the Father is calling on us to stop thinking of ourselves alone, to start thinking of other brothers and sisters, the widows, the orphans, to start thinking about people who are in the third world. There's nothing. They can barely survive. And yet we're in the first world. Can you imagine in some places, people have enough food to eat and more than enough to waste? As a matter of fact, in the first world, a lot of saints waste more food than they eat. The black beans of many families are filled. And yet, in another part of the world, a believer, born again, spirit-filled, one who even serving the Lord with all his heart, is barely able to find one meal to eat. That dysfunction, why do we accept natural borders? Why do we limit ourselves to people within our borders? And I just want to thank the Father for some people who have really touched the heart of Elohim. In the past 2 weeks, something exciting happened. The Global School of Ministry Center in Hyderabad, India, they were terribly oppressed by the heat and they needed fans. We just said it once. And you know what? A brother ran and brought some money. We sent it to the brethren there. And they were able to buy a fan. Another family on Sunday came and said, listen, that thing on India, we want to be in. And they brought, and we sent it to them. And they not only bought one fan, the balance they should have used for themselves, authorized to use for themselves. I was so touched that this couple said, Apostle, we have what we need for this period. So this money, we're going to use to buy Bibles. And it was such exciting yesterday when I saw a pile of Bibles. They want to give one to all those in the Global School of Ministry Center in Hyderabad. Can you imagine that? That act of nobility. They were authorized. After you buy the fan, use the money for your needs. Because we knew they had needs. It was so exciting that some brethren are helping to support the orphanage we are supporting in Uganda. Kids of Hope 1, Uganda 1 orphanage. Some brethren supported us. A young lady in that orphanage who is a worker, a volunteer, And she's now in college studying early education because people understood this principle. In Liberia, we got two families that have helped us to support BYC Candlelight School in Liberia, in Painesville, Liberia. We are glad that the wife of one of the leaders of IMF is now doing her nursing program, enrolled to study nursing so that she can support the family. That is the way it ought to be. That's kingdom life. Men and brethren, we can't live for ourselves. We can't be indifferent to the needs of people. And you know what? The more that the body does good, the more the hearts of people are touched and opened for the preaching of the gospel. So doing good and preaching the gospel are intertwined. The fifth dimension of the Great Commission is prayer. Prayer. We need to be invested in prayer. Yeshua said in Matthew chapter 9, verse 37, he said unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he may send forth laborers into his harvest. He said, pray about it. How many of us are still praying that prayer? Lord, raise more missionaries, local, regional, international. How many of us are praying, Lord, raise more missionaries for your harvest? Raise more people. Raise more people. How many of us know that the people we are praying for are actually in the pews as a dead, dormant laity? All we need now is to pray that pastors who are like Pharaoh, who are just calling people my member and glad with having a crowd around them, they let the Elohim's people go by teaching, training, equipping, activating them, and releasing them to serve the Lord. So let us be invested in prayer. Pray for those on the front line. Pray for those in northern Nigeria who Boko Haram has made life unbearable. And we could support those in the northern part of Nigeria. Let's pray for people who are in persecuted nations worldwide. The 1040 window. Let's pray. Let's pray the heart of people to be open for the gospel, that the hard hearts should be pierced through. Let's pray and plow hearts of people by Holy Ghost. You can be in your home, and from your home, you can literally open the door to mission fields that are closed. You can literally war in the spirit and tear down all the ramparts of Babylon created to prevent people from knowing the Lord. All the opposition of science falsely called. Curriculum that nations are now imbibing, curriculum that have no room for Elohim, that take away knowledge of Elohim. We need to pray and tear these things down. Number six is mobilizing the body to awake out of slumber to make the Great Commission the main thing. There is something that has to do with mobilization. In other words, some people need to come to a place where what we are sharing today, for instance, you understand it so clearly, you no longer allow any pastor you know to continue life as normal, business as usual. You come to that place of knowing that the world, the plan of the Father is that in our generation, we make an honest shot to turn the world upside down and to make sure that everybody has opportunity to hear the gospel, to receive the gospel, to be saved, to be discipled, to be trained. So we need people, the Lord needs people who will take it as something that they are called to do, to mobilize. Either the way you post on Facebook, the focus of your posting, the intensity of your posting, either visiting churches, either writing to churches, talking to pastors, mobilizing to make sure that we got to do this. We got to do this. We got to do it and making it clear that it's not something we should defer to another people. The kingdom is not left for other people. Then number seven, it needs to be stated that the Great Commission is global in scope, but starts right where a saint is planted, your Jerusalem. We are told in Acts 1:8, you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. So we need to know that there is a work to be done. We cannot rest because our community is evangelized. Our responsibility includes evangelization of the whole world. And we can take our place in the process. And the Father wants his people to understand something, that the kingdom has a number of dimensions. One is kingdom now, the kingdom within. When the king reigns in my heart, When he has sovereign rule in my heart, I no longer have any other ambition. I have no other desire, but I'm just available for him by his spirit to guide me into his priority and to do that. And you also the same way. Then we have the kingdom nation, which is all of us who are under the sovereign rule of Yeshua. Notwithstanding the name of our local assemblies or our location, we all are one kingdom nation of priests and kings. Then the third dimension is kingdom to come. Kingdom to come is what when he comes to set up the kingdom in the interim, and he will rule here for 1,000 years. And after the 1,000 years, he'll hand over the kingdom to his father. And the father will be all in all. Then we enter into endless eternity when for all eternity we will live with our father. Now we need to understand these things and to be invested in creating manpower for all dimensions of the kingdom. A day is coming when the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdom of his dear son. And for that reason, the father says, be diligent to know the state of your flock. Be diligent. He says in Luke chapter 19, we don't fold our hands and wait for when he's coming or wait for that star. Luke 19 and verse 11. And as he heard these things, he added and spake a parable because he was near to Jerusalem, because they thought that the kingdom of Elohim should immediately appear. And he said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. Can you imagine that? That parable is Yeshua telling us that from the day he left to the day he returns is the period of time that is called the dispensation of grace. The dispensation of grace is when the church, you and I, have the opportunity in our generation to extend the frontier of the kingdom, to use everything in us, all of our DNA, every experience of life, every gift, spiritual gift, every natural talent, every ability, we don't withhold. We're always checking, what is it that I need to apply to make sure that the wider spectrum of people hear this gospel, receive this gospel, and become part of the kingdom? And we invested in it. And it is so sad that Christians know how to make money, know how to do a lot of things and put everything in it. But when it comes to the kingdom business, they are slack about it. The father said, no. Get on with it. Use everything. Yeshua is the fullness of grace. And he says, we need to receive more grace. If we are humble, we'll receive grace. James 4, 6, that he giveth more grace. Wherefore he said, Elohim resisted the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. And 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Yeshua, to him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. Men and brethren, the Father wants to use you. These 7 dimensions of the Great Commission, you can excel in some of them. And you can be partaker in some of them. It could be your prayer, your giving, your going, above all, your witness, your life as a witness. So let's ask this question, the assignment today. Number one, in what way is grace central to fulfillment of the Great Commission? In what way is grace central? That was answered at the beginning and at the end of this training today. Number two, which of these 7 aspects of the Great Commission do you sense Elohim will be dealing with you to use you much more? Which of these 7? You need to answer these questions because they are the heart of what are you pursuing? What is the center of your life? And before we close today, we need to pray according to our arrowhead prayer. Today is day 4, tomorrow day 5, Saturday, it comes to an end. So let us pray the arrowhead prayer. I want to pray everyone, those on Facebook Live, please blog, comment, write as many comments as the Lord prompts you. And once we close this Facebook Live in a few minutes, begin to share it to as many people as possible. The Lord gives the word, great is the company. Just doing it intentionally, zealously, you know, with all the seriousness it deserves, is still part of the Great Commission you have involved, because what we are doing in the Global Advanced Mentorship Program and Authentic Kingdom Culture is a collective work. Everybody has his own part. Take your part. Let's make it happen. Now we're going to pray. Today's Arrowhead fast prayer point, prayer focus is this, that sons of Elohim, the Father has given us authority over the earth realm to dress it and to keep it. And what is our main assignment is to ensure that the will of our Father is done on earth. So Matthew chapter 6 tells us something in verse 10, the heart of that, what they call the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6 verse 10. Look at what it says here. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. It is our job to be midwives of the will of our Father in the earth realm. So today we call forth everyone who is a child of God to grow to become a son. And we're not, how do we know we are sons? When it's no longer about our stomach, our bread, our butter, what we need, when it becomes about the will of the Father, like Yeshua, who desired the will of the Father more than his food. He said, I didn't come down from heaven to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. So we be like Yeshua in seeking his will. So today we declare over the earth realm that only the will of Elohim shall prevail. Every will that is not in conformity with his will, we nullify with the blood of the Lamb. We bring the heart of kings and priests, especially those 10, along with the Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi. We bring them together, oh Father, to your will. We declare that President Vladimir Putin and Russia, President Donald J. Trump and United States, the leaders of EU, Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu and Israel, Lord President Recep Tayyip Erdogan and Turkey, we pray, Lord, that King Salman and his son, Mohammed bin Salman, and Saudi Arabia, Supreme Leader Ayatollah Khamenei and President Rouhani, and Lord, we pray, President Xi Jinping and China, and, oh Lord, Narendra Modi and India, who you added to the list today, and the North Korea and its leader, Kim Jong-un, and Lord, every single one who is part of the decision-making process of the military-industrial complex of the world system, today we bring all of them into your hand and declare that their hearts will be inclined to your will, knowingly or unknowingly. They will do just your will today and nothing but your will. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you for answering our prayer. In Yeshua's mighty name we have prayed. Amen and amen.